I just want to say thank you again to Florence and Rocky and Kevin and Keen for being here this morning with us. That was a really powerful way to start the summit. I now have the pleasure of introducing our first keynote speaker at this year's summit. And I'll just mention that John has traveled from New Haven, and we're really pleased to have him here. We, those of us at CBRC, at the Investigators, had a chance to read one of John's papers a few weeks ago. I don't know if you'll talk about it, John, but this was a paper where he really took a very creative approach to looking at what are the unique ways in which gay, bi, and queer men are experiencing stressors from an early age. A lot of us really identified with his writing and his work and are just really thrilled to hear what he has to say to start out the research sessions at the summit. So John Pachenkis is an associate professor of psychology at the Yale School of Public Health. He's also the director of the Esteem Research Group in New York City. He received his PhD in clinical psychology with a quantitative focus in 2008 from the State University of New York at Stony Brook, and completed his clinical psychology internship at Harvard Medical School and McLean Hospital. In 2012, he was a visiting scholar in health and social psychology at UCLA. His research program has two primary foci: to identify psychosocial mechanisms linking stigma-related stressors to adverse health outcomes within lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender populations, and to develop and disseminate effective health interventions to reduce sexual orientation and health disparities. Some of you will remember that at last year's summit, we had John's collaborator, Mark Hatzenbuehler, talking about how do we understand mechanisms of stigma. And so this year, we're really excited that John's going to talk about what are some of those interventions look like in response to that stigma. John's work appears in a number of journals, including Psychological Bulletin, the Journal of Counseling and Clinical Psychology, AIDS, and the American Journal of Public Health. His research has had both national and international scholarly, legal, and popular impact, having been referenced in national professional guidelines for LGBT mental health practice, cited in numerous amici curiae briefs before U.S. state and federal courts, including the U.S. Supreme Court, and featured in national and international media outlets such as the New York Times. He currently serves as principal investigator in grants from the U.S. National Institutes of Health to develop evidence-based psychosocial interventions specifically tailored to the unique mental health concerns of LGBT individuals. He examines the efficacy of LGBT affirmative interventions delivered via novel technologies, including smartphones, in diverse settings such as Eastern Europe, and with diverse segments of the LGBT community such as rural youth. Dr. Pachenkis has received several awards for his research, including most recently the 2013 Samuel Turner Early Career Award for Distinguished Contributions to Diversity in Clinical Psychology from the American Psychological Association. In addition to his academic training and research, Dr. Pachenkis has 16 years of experience in the development and delivery of health initiatives within LGBT community-based settings. So thank you for joining us, and please join me in giving a welcome to Dr. John Pachenkis.
Thank you, Travis, for that nice introduction. I have to apologize in advance for being a little tired because I flew throughout the evening and then landed here to find out the news yesterday. Obviously, this invitation was extended to me before this morning's news, and I'm glad that it still remains. It wouldn't be completely unreasonable for Canada to propose building a wall and making us Americans pay for it. But I hope that if that action did come to fruition, that the invitation would remain open to the reasonable Americans among us to continue to accept invitations like this, because it's an honor to be here. Thank you. So I'll focus today's talk on the ways that research into stigma-related stress or minority stress can inform LGBT affirmative health interventions. My work is focused on a lot of forms of minority stress or stigma-related stress, but continues to return to one key aspect of stigma-related stress in particular. We'll call that stress the closet, and discuss ways that the closet can exert long-lasting impacts on the health of gay, bisexual, and other queer men who have sex with men, as well as the ways that evidence-based interventions can alleviate the mental health and other associated health impacts of stigma. So my work is motivated by this consistent fact, and that's that across data sets that have assessed sexual orientation, we see that LGB individuals are about twice as likely to experience any mood disorder, any anxiety disorder, or any substance use disorder, as well as clear comorbidities across those disorders compared to heterosexuals. We know from lots of research using diverse methodologies and measurement approaches that the root of these disparities can largely be attributed to stigma-related stress that LGB individuals face that that heterosexuals don't. So to understand and ultimately intervene on these disparities, a lot of my work and the work of others have looked at the mechanisms through which stigma compromises mental health. Some of those mechanisms are cognitive, such as chronic kind of anxious expectations of rejection, affective, such as shame or poor emotion regulation, and behavioral, including diminished agency, including diminished agency for protecting one's health, as well as unassertive interpersonal behavior. But like I said, my work keeps returning to sexual orientation concealment as one of the key mechanisms through which stigma impacts the mental health of LGB individuals. Sexual orientation concealment is something that all sexual minority individuals do, if even just from the time that they first become aware of their sexual orientation to the time that they first disclose their sexual orientation. Even today, that period still spans all of adolescence, all of high school from age among gay and bisexual men, like age 13 to age 18 or 19. Even among those who are out, the closet still drives behavior, is a function of perceived stigma in the environment. LGB individuals may choose to conceal in various contexts. When conceptualized as the social structures that compromise open self-expression, that diminish self-worth, and ultimately jeopardize health, the closet can really be seen as a lifelong experience and one that will continue to persist in societal contexts of unequal power and inequities. And in fact, some sexual minorities never disclose their sexual orientation. This is true both in Western countries as well as countries around the globe, which poses unique challenges and opportunities to researching the mental health of individuals who have never disclosed their sexual orientation. So today, I'll attempt to answer these questions. The first are, what are the mental health implications of the closet? Why do some sexual minorities conceal their sexual orientation? What are the mental health implications of the closet during adolescence? How can we promote resilience from the closet? And how can we promote the mental health of those individuals who are truly hidden across the globe? So several years ago, I reviewed the literature on stigma concealment, and found that there were studies that showed that showed positive associations between concealment and health, negative associations between concealment and health, and sometimes no associations. And as seen here, these are just a few of the studies that have shown various cognitive, affective, and behavioral reasons why stigma might be associated with good health, why concealment might be associated with good health, and why concealment might be associated with poor health. The inconsistent associations between concealment and health might have to do with a couple of things. One is that one are the kind of inconsistent ways that sexual minorities are recruited into those studies. Another are maybe problems of or inconsistent ways of assessing concealment among those individuals in those studies. So most research on sexual minorities relies on convenience samples of relatively out participants. So they're basically assessing concealment or disclosure among people who are publicly visible by virtue of signing up to participate in a research study. Concealment among these individuals is typically assessed as the different social contexts that one's out. How out are you to your family, to your friends, to your medical providers, or as like a personality trait. how often in general do you conceal your sexual orientation? Or as kind of like in daily diary studies, a context-dependent fluctuation that depends on things like perceived stigma that might vary day to day depending on the demands of those situations. But the experiences of sexual minorities who have never disclosed their sexual orientation are virtually unstudied. So my colleagues Susan Cochran and Vicky Mays at UCLA conducted one of the first probability-based studies of LGBT-specific health concerns. And in this type of design, they randomly selected individuals from the population to really probe the unique experiences of sexual minorities. Now, they had to do a couple of kind of ingenious and challenging things to make this happen. They first had to talk the California Health Interview Survey, which is a survey of the state of California. It recruits tens of thousands of participants every few years. They had to talk the CHIS into simply letting them assess sexual orientation and recent same-sex sexual behavior. But even more impressively, they then got permission from the CHIS to follow back every single sexual minority or person who seemed like a sexual minority in the CHIS to ask them detailed questions about their sexual orientation. So their follow-back study to the CHIS included an interviewer-based mental health assessment as well as detailed questions of things like sexual orientation concealment. I noticed in working with them on this data set that triangulating across a few different questions where we could be pretty sure based on the ways these questions were asked and the ways that they were kind of repeatedly asked, that there were 90 men and 52 women who reported never having disclosed their sexual orientation to another person. And again, because this is a probability-based survey, we can derive estimates that might generalize to the full population, in this case, at least the state of California. So in models that controlled for demographic covariates, including HIV status, we found that men who had never told anyone of their sexual orientation actually reported significantly better mental health. They had lower odds of major depression than men who were out. Whereas the opposite effect was found for women. Women who were out had a marginally lower likelihood of experiencing depression compared to women who were out. The CalQOL also allowed us to assess to predict mental health from the length of time that someone had been out of the closet. So this allowed us to contest competing hypotheses, for example, whether being recently out of the closet was particularly stressful and associated with mental health for people, or whether being recently out of the closet was ushered in a period of like developmental growth and identity formation, which might stave off mental health consequences. Using this length of time from the closet variable, we could also look at the implications of being out of the closet for the long term. Among people from lower socioeconomic groups and racial and ethnic minorities, we know that the longer people live with those identities, the poorer their mental health becomes over time because of kind of a stress accumulation effect. It's also possible, though, that being out for a long period of time among sexual minorities could lead to greater identity integration with other aspects of their identity, finding supportive community, et cetera, so that you would see that as people are out longer, their mental health actually improves. And so we wanted to know what the long-term implications of being out were in this next set of analyses. So models that controlled for demographic covariates, including age and the age at which someone first became aware of their sexual orientation, we found that men who were recently coming out, so like in the first 8 years after coming out, actually reported higher odds of major depression than men who were closeted. Whereas women who were coming out actually reported significantly lower odds of major depression than those who were closeted and those who had been out for a long period of time. Looking at generalized anxiety disorder, we see among men that the period right after coming out is associated with the highest odds of generalized anxiety disorder compared to being closeted and being out for a long period of time. Whereas for women, there was no significant difference in mental health outcomes across outness status. So in summary, for this first study, we see that recently out men had the highest odds of mental health problems, whereas recently out women had the lowest odds of mental health problems, and that closeted men actually had the lowest odds of depression than anyone. So this gender-specific pattern of findings could be explained by a couple of things. The first is that simply that men who are out violate gender roles in a way that women don't. The cost of gender role violations for men is greater than it is for women. Therefore, men might experience more disproportionate stress as a result of being out. We also know that heterosexual life in general, disproportionately disadvantages women compared to men. Women in unhappy relationships report poorer health than men in unhappy relationships, maybe because of gender-specific coping styles in unhappy relationships. And so because many of the closeted individuals in the sample were actually in heterosexual relationships, we may simply see that that kind of living heterosexually disproportionately disadvantages women compared to men. But we also know in the general population that women are twice as likely to be depressed as men, and it could just be that the mental health of closeted people is the same as the mental health of heterosexuals, which is another possibility. It's also possible that concealment might be particularly stressful for women, maybe because of gender-specific coping styles, or maybe because concealment additively or synergistically interacts with other stressors to which women are disproportionately exposed, like socioeconomic disadvantage. So turning our attention to the next question, why do some sexual minorities conceal their sexual orientation? The answer to this question is typically argued to be that people decide whether or not to come out or whether or not to conceal based on the pros and cons that they perceive to coming out, as well as kind of their past experiences with disclosure. But the fact that stigmatizing social structures might ultimately determine why people come out or whether people come out has not been examined to my knowledge. But the relevance of the environment to sexual orientation has been talked about. It's even been talked about by the likes of President Obama, who said last year, "Tonight, somewhere in America, a young person, let's say a young man, will struggle to fall asleep, wrestling alone with the secret he's held as long as he can remember. Soon, perhaps, he'll decide to let that secret out. What happens next depends on his family, on him, his family, as well as his friends and teachers and his community. But it also depends on us, the kind of society we engender, the type of future we build." Yet the role of the environment in determining whether or not people come out hasn't been explored. So some reasons for this might be because studies of concealment typically are measured like in the same state or the same community or like even in the same like school, so that there's insufficient environmental variation in structures from which, in environments from which to predict concealment. We also know that it's unethical to randomly assign people to experience stigma or not stigma, so we don't have that option. And most studies on concealment rely on self-reports. We know that self-reports of mental health and stigma are potentially confounded by same source reporting bias, as well as known confounds between stress exposure and mental health. But the European MSM Internet Survey overcomes all of these limitations. To my knowledge, it's the largest and most geographically diverse survey of gay and bisexual men that's existed. It spans 38 European countries and was a joint effort of several parties, including the World Health Organization, the European CDC, government health institutes across Europe, academic partners, NGOs, as well as two prominent media sites, Manhunt and Gay Romeo. And it was administered in 25 languages so that all the terms and whatnot were comparable across countries, which in many cases look drastically different from each other. And it was really, the study was really done to establish the HIV-related prevention needs, especially among gay, bisexual, and other MSM in Eastern Europe, where attention to HIV-related issues has typically been lower than in the West. So the MS therefore provided kind of this unprecedented opportunity to look at structural or environmental determinants of concealment. And for our main predictor, we characterized each country in terms of its support for LGBT people. We did this by using the European Value Survey, which is a probability survey of 1,500 people in each European country that simply assesses people's opinions on pressing social needs, including the legitimacy of homosexuality, to gather a sense of the social standing of different population groups across Europe. We also did this by calculating the presence or absence of protective and discriminatory policies towards LGBT individuals, including things like same-sex marriage, including things like prohibitions against even congregating in public as sexual minorities, things that, like you see in places like Russia. And we assigned each country a Z-score for its presence of stigmatizing attitudes using the European Value Survey, and we assigned each country a Z-score for its presence of stigmatizing policies and absence of protective policies. Then we combined those Z-scores to characterize each European country in terms of its stigma towards LGBT individuals. And then we assess concealment, using this question in the MS. Thinking about all the people who know you, including family, friends, and work or study colleagues, what proportion know that you're attracted to men? And then we define being concealed as being out to none or very few people. So in addition to our hypothesis that country-level stigma would predict concealment, we also hypothesized that concealment would predict HIV risk, in that men who are concealed would be underground and out of reach of HIV prevention services, for example. We also predicted that country-level stigma would predict HIV risk, and that countries that were more homophobic would be less likely to offer protective or preventive services to the sexual minorities living in those countries. And then finally, we proposed that the relationship between country-level stigma and HIV risk would be accounted for by the fact that in more homophobic countries, you have more men who conceal, who are therefore more underground or and out of reach of prevention services. So our HIV risk outcomes included HIV preventive knowledge, HIV preventive services and service usage, in HIV preventive behavior. Because this study specifically focused on HIV and HIV surveillance, these questions were asked in great detail, including, for example, HIV knowledge quizzes, in-depth assessments of when people were last screened for STIs, how they were screened, what they were screened for, what the results of those screenings were, et cetera. So for covariates, we entered individual and country-level confounds that could potentially account for the relationship between stigma and HIV and these HIV outcomes. And what we found is that for every one standard deviation increase on our structural stigma index, we found that men's odds of concealment was doubled. So that in countries like the Netherlands and the UK and other countries in the West, you have the vast majority of sexual minority men being open with others about their sexual orientation. But in countries in the East, places like Russia and Ukraine, you have the majority of sexual minority men actually being concealed to everyone or to almost everyone in their lives. Kind of arguing for the fact that Sweden and Russia are much further apart in terms of homophobia than they are in kilometers, and that they're geographic neighbors, but the experience of gay and bisexual men in those countries couldn't be much different. To test the second pathway, we examined the association between concealment and HIV preventive knowledge, services, and behavior, and found a significant association across all of those outcomes. And then we tested the third pathway between country-level stigma and HIV preventive knowledge, services, and behaviors, and also found a significant association. And then finally, we tested mediation and found evidence for the fact that country-level stigma predicted HIV a lack of HIV preventive knowledge, services, and behavior because structural stigma was also associated with men in homophobic countries being concealed from others in their lives. So the results of this study suggest, obviously, the importance of attending to social structures and policies and laws as a driver of the HIV epidemic, both to protect the health of gay and bisexual men, but also another reason to focus on laws and policies and attitudes towards sexual minority men is simply because those things have the potential to constrain open self-expression kind of as an end outcome in and of themselves. So in addition to examining kind of the experience of sexual minorities who are closeted and environmental determinants of the closet, we've also been exploring the psychological experiences of the period of time between first becoming aware of one's sexual orientation and first disclosing one's sexual orientation, which for most people happens during adolescence and spans all of adolescence. This period of time is often called the closet among adolescents. So to get a sense of the implications of the health implications of this period for gay men, I turned to my bookshelf and noted several themes across gay men's coming of age narratives. So across these narratives, we see themes like this. Feeling like outsiders, they often, meaning gay men, often remain peripheral to the peer groups that are so essential in helping them feel acceptable and accepted. Therefore, many are forced to become relatively free of reliance on peer approval and more reliant on their internal resources. Suggesting that because stigma makes acceptance uncertain, it's a safer strategy for gay and bisexual men to rely on on themselves and their own internal resources as opposed to others' approval. And another theme like this, where Andrew Tobias in his memoir, The Best Little Boy in the World, which may be one of the first kind of coming of age stories written by a gay man about his coming out experiences, he noted that another important line of defense, the most important on a practical day-to-day basis, was my prodigious list of activities. No one could expect me to be out dating when I had a list of 17 urgent projects to complete. Suggesting that a focus on achievement is a solid strategy to avoid being discovered because of one's sexual orientation. And here, law professor Kenji Yoshino similarly cites achievement as a way to stay concealed. I sensed these bodies knew other bodies the way I knew calculus or Shakespeare. I knew only I was asked to not be myself, and that to be myself, to fail to meet that demand was to make myself illegible, my future unimaginable. On Saturday nights, I would sit in my cement block dorm room with my face lit green by my IBM's glow, agonizing not over women or men, but line breaks, suggesting that through overachievement, one might be able to stay concealed or stay concealed from others or even from oneself. So psychologist Jennifer Crocker persuasively suggest that self-esteem, rather than being kind of a unitary trait that people possess, is best conceptualized as made up of being contingent on various life domains, and that by strategically investing our self-worth in those domains in which we're particularly likely to succeed, we might be able to protect our self-worth against threat. So in her scheme, she has these kind of sources of self-worth that people derive their self-worth from. So we conducted a study based on the premise that without sexual orientation disclosure, acceptance can't be guaranteed. So young gay and bisexual men might preserve their self-worth by investing or over-investing their self-worth in those domains that were free of reliance on others' approval and more reliant on their own internal effort and striving. So in Crocker's scheme, this suggests that since concealment denies young gay and bisexual men the opportunity to receive esteem based on others' approval or family support or God's love or being seen as a virtuous person, it might be safer instead for gay and bisexual men to invest in life domains in which one relies on himself and his own efforts. So in this framework, this leaves us with competition-based self-worth, academic-based self-worth, and appearance-based self-worth. Yet we know that staking one's self-worth in these achievement-related domains often comes at a health cost. We know from previous research with the general population that the more people invest their self-worth in these achievement-related domains, the more they experience problems interpersonally, in relationships, in mental health, and in health risk behaviors. So we hypothesized that young gay and bisexual men would report more achievement-related contingent self-worth compared to heterosexual men, and that the degree to which they invested in that achievement contingent self-worth would be predicted by the length of time that they had spent in the closet during their adolescence or childhoods. We also hypothesize that, consistent with previous research, that the degree to which young gay and bisexual men invested in these achievement-related domains, the more their kind of mental health and health risks would be jeopardized. So we recruited sexual minority and heterosexual men from comparable campus groups. The sexual minority men came from LGBT campus groups, and the heterosexual men came from other groups that were kind of organized around social identities. And we calculated the length of time that one was in the closet based on asking them when they first became aware of their sexual orientation and when they first disclosed their sexual orientation. And then we administered Crocker's contingent self-worth scale, including the 7 self-worth domains. For example, from the competition-related self-worth domain, knowing that I'm better than others on a task raises my self-esteem, or from the family support self-worth domain, when my family members are proud of me, my sense of self-worth increases. And we entered relevant covariates, and then conducted a 10-day daily diary study, such that for every day for 10 consecutive days, we asked men to report the degree to which they engaged in a range of behaviors, the amount of time they spent with other people those days, the quality of their interactions with others were on those days, and behavioral outcomes, things like social isolation or cheating or getting into arguments, et cetera. And our results showed that gay and bisexual men did in fact report more achievement contingent self-worth compared to heterosexual men, and that the length of time that one was in the closet was significantly associated with each of those achievement contingent self-worth domains. So the longer period of time that one had concealed a sexual orientation, the more likely he was to invest his self-worth in appearance-related concerns, being the best at competitive tasks, and striving through schoolwork. And consistent with previous findings, we found that the degree to which sexual minority men invested in those contingent self-worth achievement-related domains, the more likely they were to experience poor health behaviors and mental health on those days. So in sum, gay men reported higher achievement-related self-worth compared to heterosexual men, which was predicted by the length of time that they were in the closet. And achievement-related self-worth was also, consistent with previous research, predicted unhealthy behaviors on those days. So the closet may have, these results suggest that the closet may have long-lasting implications for one's experience of self-worth. Without disclosure, one's acceptance can never be fully guaranteed, so it instead might be a safer strategy or one strategy to compensate for the threat of stigma or rejection by investing in those domains that only rely on oneself and his own striving. But our results also show that these attempts to be the best little boy in the world often can come at a cost to mental and interpersonal health. So we now have accumulating evidence across studies like this and other studies that stigma exerts its impact on mental health through processes like concealment, through processes like contingent self-worth, and other mechanisms specific to sexual minorities. For example, internalized stigma, anticipated rejection, as well as mechanisms that are risk factors for mental health problems in the general population, but that happen to be elevated among sexual minorities. Things like unassertive interpersonal behavior, social isolation, diminished agency, rumination, and low self-worth. One benefit of knowing the targets through which stigma impacts mental health is that it tells us where we need to direct our interventions. If we can target these basic processes like concealment or like contingent self-worth or like anxious expectations of rejection or social isolation or poor emotion regulation, we might be able to improve the mental health of LGB individuals. And so our team is currently developing a mental health and health risk behavior intervention that does just that. Project Esteem stands for Effective Skills to Empower Effective Men. And It's an intervention that seeks to reduce the pathways through which stigma operates, to improve mental health, sexual health, and behavioral health, things like substance use outcomes among gay and bisexual men. We created Esteem by consulting with 21 experts across the U.S. These were people who were currently engaged in mental health practice with LGBT individuals. They'd been engaged in mental health practice in some cases for many decades with LGBT individuals, who had also kind of published case reports or studies or scholarly literature on LGBT mental health. We also consulted with 20 young gay and bisexual men in individual interviews where we sat down with them and asked them to describe ways that they had coped with stigma, things that they had found both formal sources of support as well as informal sources of support. We asked the experts and the community members how they could imagine an intervention operating that could target those kind of basic processes. So we kind of presented this model to them and then asked through these in-depth interviews how these targets might be addressed through through interventions. And so what we did was we took a basic cognitive behavioral therapy platform, which is a standard kind of evidence-based treatment for things like depression and anxiety, and infused the entire intervention with the suggestions that we got from the community members and the experts. So some examples of the suggestions and the suggested techniques and principles that informed the intervention were things like consciousness raising being an education about the impact of stigma-related stress and being aware of kind of the insidious impact that stigma-related stress can have on mental health that often occurs even outside of our own awareness. Another principle involves restructuring kind of minority stress thinking patterns, things like chronic anxious expectations of rejection or low self-worth that might emerge from, that research shows emerges from exposure to stigma. Another principle was assertive communication. Many of the experts, if not most of the experts we talked to, discussed the ways that stigma could erode kind of gay and bisexual men's ability to trust themselves and to trust them to trust themselves and their emotions as kind of accurate guides for how to navigate situations and kind of eroding their ability to stand up for themselves. So one principle that Esteem has is to encourage kind of open self-expression, obviously in situations where it's safe to do so. Another principle was to facilitate emotion awareness and acceptance, recognizing the ways that kind of early exposure to minority stress and stigma can teach gay and bisexual men that their emotions are shameful or things that aren't accurate or things they shouldn't have or things that they shouldn't express. And instead, and so what this part of the intervention does is instills healthy kind of emotion awareness and emotion expression strategies that might be compromised by earlier ongoing exposure to stigma-related stress. The fifth principle that we incorporated was a focus on kind of supportive relationships and healthy sexuality, based on kind of community members and experts' impressions that have also been confirmed by the literature that stigma can kind of erode one's ability to do things like assert condom usage or to openly express intimacy or sexual desires. And to do so in a way, many of the men we talked to talked about sex as being something that that happened kind of only under the influence of drugs or alcohol or something that they felt kind of out of control of. We saw a lot of evidence of kind of sexual compulsivity or things or situations where men or the community experts who were working with them reported that that many men, especially those coping with depression and anxiety, may not have learned how to kind of articulate their sexual needs and sexual health goals and to achieve those goals in a way that promotes their health and kind of self-worth. And the final principle that were suggested across these interviews were to validate gay and bisexual men's unique strengths. Unlike a lot of stigmatized groups like racial and ethnic minorities, for example, who typically share their stigma with their parents, most gay and bisexual men don't have parents who are also gay and bisexual men. There are also issues in kind of mentorship across generations, some of which has to do with the kind of decimation of the older cohort of gay and bisexual men through HIV. Other issues may have to do with kind of seeing older gay men who are involved in mentorship of younger gay men as predatory or something like that, which can pose challenges to kind of effective cross-generational mentorship and also the cross-generational transmission of information about the true resilience of the gay and bisexual community. So another one of the principles that kind of informs the intervention is educating gay and bisexual men about their own personal strengths, including navigating the coming out process, which is something that all gay and bisexual men have had to grapple with at some point, but also kind of instilling education about the historical legacy of social and sexual creativity demonstrated across the gay and bisexual community, which has a long history of activism, kind of shamelessness and pride. And so then we tested this treatment in a waitlist control trial where men either were randomized to receive either Project Esteem or to be on a waitlist in this first trial. And we found that Esteem significantly reduced gay and bisexual men. This was a 10-week intervention delivered by trained psychologists or counselors. And we found that receiving the intervention significantly reduced depression, anxiety, alcohol use problems, sexual compulsivity, marginally significantly reduced days of heavy drinking, and significantly reduced anal sex acts without a condom with casual partners. We also found that the intervention, we also found preliminary evidence for the fact that men who received the intervention after, compared to before, after they received the intervention, they showed significant reductions in rejection sensitivity, internalized homophobia. Of course, in a talk focused on concealment, this was like the one mechanism that we didn't find reduced, but probably because there was range restriction in the measure and that most of the men who received the treatment were already pretty out. We found significant reductions between before and after treatment and rumination, marginally significant reductions in emotion dysregulation, and significant reductions in unassertiveness. So we basically put community wisdom to the test and found that it works. So we now have a treatment that's capable of targeting kind of the co-occurring health, mental health, sexual health, and behavioral health issues that disproportionately affect gay and bisexual men. Because the treatment targets the underlying stress pathways involved in all of those outcomes, we see reductions across all those outcomes with this one treatment, which potentially lends itself to broad dissemination of the treatment because it cuts down on the need for like separate trainings and single outcome treatments. For example, learning how to treat depression, learning how to treat alcohol use problems, learning how to treat sexual compulsivity, et cetera. By targeting the underlying pathways, we can target all of those outcomes simultaneously. So future directions in our intervention research have involved looking at moderators of the treatment effects, so for whom does the treatment work particularly well, as well as the pathways through which the treatment works. So for example, we're doing this by, no one comes to treatment saying that they're internally homophobic. Like, it just doesn't happen. But we do know that internalized homophobia can kind of impact people in kind of subtle, insidious ways. So we used an implicit measure of internalized homophobia, basically a quick reaction time test, whereby we look at the difference between gay men's ability to associate themselves with positive traits versus their ability to associate themselves with negative traits using a computer keypad measured in millisecond differences, and found that gay men who are more likely to have implicit negative attitudes about their sexual orientation benefited from the treatment more than those who had lower implicit negative attitudes about their sexual orientation. And, we used an explicit measure of internalized homophobia and didn't find a similar pattern of results, suggesting that there might be unique kind of measures, novel measures that we can do to pick up on some of the more subtle processes that might be impacting gay and bisexual men's cognitive and emotional processes. We're now testing Esteem in a multi-site trial with 250 young gay and bisexual men in New York City and Miami, where men either are randomly assigned to receive Project Esteem or community mental health treatment as usual, or one session HIV testing and counseling. This will allow us to determine the added efficacy of incorporating a focus on LGBT affirmative by incorporating a focus on early and ongoing minority stressors. It'll also allow us to test the cost effectiveness of, for example, adding mental health treatment to something like HIV testing and counseling. The way that most men receive kind of psychosocial health services is when they go to get an HIV test. But we know that that's limited in terms of time and in terms of potential impact on synergistic or co-occurring health behaviors. We're also looking at we're trying to justify the cost effectiveness of adding a focus on mental and sexual health into that. And to reach those who are truly hidden, we've also trained psychologists to deliver a modified version of esteem to young gay and bisexual men in Romania. So in this study, we trained therapists to deliver esteem in Romanian to young gay and bisexual men ages 13 to 21 using smartphones. So Romania has, it's a kind of a high-tech country, but otherwise has no LGB affirmative like brick and mortar services. Like you can't go get LGB affirmative mental health treatment. Most gay and bisexual men in Romania lie about the sex they're having. They wouldn't tell a provider that they're having anal sex with a man. If they present with things like anal gonorrhea, things like this that you could probably only get by having sex with a man. There are stories of kind of being shamed out of the office and yelled at and embarrassed in waiting rooms, et cetera. The stories go on and on. But one way to bypass this kind of lack of brick and mortar LGB affirmative health services is to actually reach young gay and bisexual men using devices that they're already using, namely things like smartphones. The compliance with the study was almost perfect in that nearly every man who enrolled in the treatment ended up completing all 10 sessions of the treatment. And we also found preliminary efficacy that the treatment significantly reduced mental health, sexual health, and alcohol use problems in this population. And we're gearing up to do the same in rural Appalachia in the U.S., the same type of situation where there aren't brick-and-mortar LGBT health clinics or mental health clinics, but we can still reach men through through smartphones. In our New York City pilot, before we delivered this in Romania and Appalachia, we tried out the intervention delivered by smartphones in New York and found significant reductions pre to post-treatment in number of days of heavy drinking, drug use days, condomless sex acts under the influence. So in conclusion, this is an exciting time to be studying gay and bisexual men's health. For the first time, we're starting to collect evidence on how mental health is patterned by minority stress exposure, how minority stress exposure varies across structural climates globally, and how early kind of experiences with stigma-related stress might kind of deeply affect the self-worth of gay men across the life course. And with this evidence and more in hand, we can continue to develop interventions to target the pathways that are driving these health outcomes to ultimately deliver those who are truly in need of our services, thereby improving the health of this kind of large segment of the global community. So with that said, I just wanted to briefly acknowledge all the individuals who contributed to this work and all the funding sources of this work, without whom none of this would have been even close to possible. Thank you. So I'm happy to take questions now. There are two microphones on either side of the room for anyone to use who has a question.
I guess I just wanted to clarify the acronym for Esteem because I was trying to look it up on Google and there was a whole bunch of other projects showing up under it.
There's a whole bunch of what?
Other projects, I guess.
Oh, yep.
What did Esteem stand for again, sir?
Effective skills to empower effective men. I can send you a website, too, where you could read more about it.
Yeah. Hi there. That was really great. Thank you so much. Jamie from the University of British Columbia School of Population and Public Health. I was really interested particularly in the intervention and the engagement in the intervention. Can you talk a little bit more about like problems with retention or engaging people in the intervention and what effect that might have on the outcomes that you presented today?
Sure, yeah. It's a great question. It's a particularly a great question given the theme of this year's conference. Because, you know, potentially because of the kind of subtle and insidious ways that stigma works, it is very, most young gay and bisexual men are highly resistant to a victim narrative. So they're very unlikely to say that, yes, stigma impacts me. If anything, the kind of modal response that we get in the intervention is, it's 2016 in New York City. Like, things couldn't be better. And so one challenge that we have in the intervention, and that the therapists who deliver the intervention have, is how to communicate the more subtle impacts that minority stress and stigma might have on people's lives without invalidating this otherwise really healthy narrative that they aren't victims, right, and that they aren't stigmatized. And so it's one thing that the therapists kind of deal with on an ongoing basis. Some of the kind of early psychoeducation components of the intervention get through some of that, because a lot of men through like the kind of consciousness raising exercises will become aware of the fact that, yes, in fact, they could imagine ways that earlier ongoing experiences with the stuff still impacts them. A lot of them actually note that the most proximal source of stress in their lives, and this is somewhat disturbing and maybe something for us to talk about further, is actually other gay men. So they'll notice that they'll say things like, you know, again, we're recruiting for men who are depressed, anxious, and at risk of HIV. But they'll say things like, the gay community is racist, the gay community discriminates against people who are positive, the gay community is ageist, the gay community is sex-focused or status-focused, it's hard to make friends in urban gay communities, the gay community is gossipy, et cetera, which then kind of poses this challenge. Well, those aren't really stigma-related stressors, but is there a way that those things might ultimately have their source in kind of larger homophobia? And so all those things are kind of things that we've learned along the way, just in terms of listening to the narratives that men bring. But we do find that we're able to kind of engage men, even those who don't present with a kind of minority stress conceptualization, we're still able to engage them around some of these other things. But yeah, I mean, recruitment is both challenging and not. I mean, with things like Grindr, you can, you know, we screen, every time we send a Grindr blast, we have something like 130 men who screen eligible, and that they're depressed and anxious, at risk of HIV infection, not on PrEP, and live in New York. And, you know, they're between the ages of 18 and 29. But of those who actually, you know, say that they're interested in mental health treatment and stick to the therapy, the numbers are much smaller. So, yeah, those are just some general thoughts.
No, that's great. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Great. Thanks again for a terrific talk. A little bit further to what Jamie said. So how was your intervention sort of sold to the population? Like, what were you saying that you were looking? I mean, obviously, you got quite a few eligibility criteria there, but how do what were the public messaging around that? Because one of the challenges that I've seen with sort of, you know, psychologically based HIV prevention efforts is that typically people that are often the people that are at highest risk for acquiring HIV aren't going to be able to commit to, you know, 10, you know, hour long sessions. But if you're selling this as kind of more kind of a holistic approach to kind of mental health, is that kind of a way forward?
I mean, I'm not convinced that it's hard to know if we're doing it in the best way or not. Yeah. Because we haven't tested our recruitment strategy against anything else. But you know, I mean, our materials have a heavy focus on, I mean, the recruitment materials themselves say things like anxious, lonely, feeling rejected, ? Mm-hmm. You know, and a lot of that derives from kind of the interviews and focus groups that we did in preparation for the study, things that gay men said that they were dealing with that they would like help around. Otherwise, the recruitment materials are, you know, LGB affirmative and friendly without being kind of too over the top LGBT focused, again, to attract men for whom that, you know, who might not see themselves as needing a gay specific treatment. Otherwise, you know, I think providing mental health services is something that fills a need. In New York, there are not great mental health services, certainly affordable mental health services. You have a situation where the probably the best mental health services are all, you know, private pay, and you have to pay hundreds of dollars per session and things like this. And everyone kind of knows this. Otherwise, you can go to kind of an overworked, overburdened community center and receive, you know, like a very short course of treatment that may or may not be what you are looking for. So I think by focusing on mental health, we're kind of filling a need. Yeah,
so I think you're actually describing mental health services in British Columbia perfectly well, too. So I'm kind of interested in the model where you're talking about delivering these services remotely. So you were saying that you're using a smartphone. Like, is that just, like, telephone conversation, or is it some combination of, you know, web-based plus face-to-face
stuff? It's a good question. I should have clarified. We had a web programmer build an app that it's basically like Facebook chat or something without, well, it's like Facebook chat where men in the study sign up at the same time that their therapist is available. The therapist conducts therapy as usual. As a clinical psychologist, I was kind of horrified by the like suggestion that we do something like this. I mean, really, like when we started thinking about it, I was like, there's no way that we can deliver mental health services through chat. But actually one of the most rewarding things in my kind of weekly life is getting the translated transcripts from the sessions in Romania and seeing that language is language. You do miss out on nonverbal stuff and there's some like miscommunication stuff, but otherwise it seems to be effective. Using smartphones and that type of platform also has the benefit of being able to connect the men with each other, which we're still brainstorming how to do in a larger trial, the men who are receiving the treatment in a social networking type of way.
Great, thank you.
Yep.
Looks like we have two last questions, and I'll just ask you keep them on the briefer side so we can stay on schedule.
Great, thank you so much. I'm Ellen with Vancouver Coastal Health. I'm particularly interested in the results of your esteem project in reducing adverse risk behavior, but I'm curious about the follow-up period for the post-treatment and the sustainability of the intervention.
Yep, and so the follow-up period in the first trial was 3 months, and the results that I showed were those 3 month, was at the 3 month follow-up. In the trial that we're doing now, the follow-up is 12 months.
Okay.
And then, you know, we're very open to continuing to follow them as long as, like, funds allow. But we don't have those data yet.
Great. Thank you.
Yep. Hi, thank you very much. Alan Lee from Toronto, Asian Community Services. I'm interested to find out, like, you said the intervention is a 10-week intervention. Is that, like, how long is the sessions, and is that group sessions versus individuals? And
it's another important point. The intervention is currently delivered individually in one-on-one sessions that last an hour each, although there's no great reason to not do it in groups other than the feasibility of scheduling, and it's certainly something that that we should pursue into the future because of the kind of enhanced effectiveness of talking about some of these things in group context.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks again, John. And I think you'll be around for both days of the summit. So if people have additional questions, you can certainly approach John and chat with him. Thank you.